Good morning to all of you.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, good morning. Today we will discuss the policy label shift which is proposed by National Education Policy 1968, then the 1986 with the amendment in the 1992, and we will also see the what is the policy perspective proposed by National Education Policy 2020. NEP 2020 is not in our syllabus because we know that the syllabus was framed before coming the new education policy. But when we talk about the policy label change which is proposed by the National Education Policy, then it is also important to discuss the new education policy, what the new education policy says about the examination reform, what kind of a reform is proposed by the NEP 2020. This discussion we will divide in two parts. Today we will see the NEP 1968 and 86 with modification in 1992. So today we will be discussing these two things. In the next class we will discuss about the policy level decision taken by the NEP 2020. So first we will start with the National Education Policy 1968. When you will see, I think, have you seen the NEP 1968 original document? So when you will see the NEP 1968, it is a very small document. Okay, this is the very small document, and it is of only 8 pages. You can see that total 8 pages there, and within this 8 page, only one paragraph about the assessment is this is the only one paragraph about the examination reform is proposed by the NEP 1968, and this is the NEP 1986 with modification in 1992. This is the modified one, and wherever it is modified, you will find that this is the airstrike is given, like that. This is inserted in the modified one. So here the star mark is given. So this is a little bit comprehensive one. This is of 46 page, and if you want to see the original document of 86, this is the original document of 86. It is only of 32 page. National Education Policy, National Policy on Education 1986. So this is of 32 page. All these documents are available in the NCERT website. If you are interested, you can download from there also. Then now come to the NEP 1968, what is proposed by the 1986. When we talk about the NEP 1986, it says that the major goal of examination reform by this policy to improve the reliability and validity of examination. The point of saying is that the examination should be reliable and valid. I think in the assessment paper, when the Mandal sir was teaching you the different unit of the same paper, he must talked about the reliability and validity. The first thing is that the evaluation that we are doing, that must be reliable. It must be reliable. Reliability says that if the test is conducted to a different set of population. Okay, suppose that I am conducting a test in a Bhubaneswar, which is a city. If you are conducting a test in a Cuttack, which is again is a big city of Orissa. If we are conducting a test even in the remote area of Orissa. Okay, so or if we are conducting a test in other area of the country, for sake of example, the CBSE board used to conduct, which is conducted throughout over the country, which is affiliated to the CBSE board. Or when we talk about the state board, suppose that the Orissa state board, the examination is conducted, board examination is conducted throughout the Orissa, irrespective of the geographical area, irrespective of the whether it is a metropolitan city or a city or a urban area, semi-urban area, rural area, tribal area, remote area, whatever. Whether the students are studying in the private school or whether the students are studying in the government school or any kind of a schooling. A same set of a question is administered throughout the population. And this reliability says that it must give same or a similar kind of achievement score throughout the population. It must be reliable one. And a reliability, you can think that it must be a kind of a tool on which you can faith, you can bank upon, you can believe the truthness of the test tool. Suppose that if I am administering a test in a very remote area and the average score, average I am talking, not the individual score, average score of a student is falling between 50 to 60%. And when it is administered to the metropolitan cities, it is giving achievement, average achievement score of 80 to 90%. Then we cannot say that the test tool is a valid one, because it is a giving average score which is entirely skewed one. It is not it does not have a correlation with the achievement score conducted over the two places. Okay, suppose that in the Kandhamal I am conducting, and suppose that in the Bhuvneshwar I am conducting. So in the Kandhamal it is giving average score of 50 to 60%, whereas in the Bhuvneshwar it is giving average score of 80 to 90%. So we cannot say that it is a reliable one. So reliability is a measure of a tool which gives the consistency in the score. Consistency of a test tool is known as the reliability. It must give the consistent score. Okay. And similarly, when we talk about the validity, validity of a test item or a test tool is measured in term of what it is intended to measure. Whether it is measuring or not, what it is intended. Suppose that you are constructing a test tool to measure the creativity, and if the test item, test tool fails to measure the creativity, or you are developed a test tool to assess and evaluate the remembering power, understanding, memory, analysis, synthesis, whatever the objective of the test tool is that. If it is not able to measure that, then we cannot say that it is a valid one. Hana? So validity and a reliability. Validity is that whether it is measuring for what it is intended to measure. And the reliability is the consistency. Consistent, then we can say that it is a reliable. And if it is a measuring what is it is intended to measure, then we can say that it is a valid test tool. So this is the concept of a reliability and a validity in a brief. So this 1986 proposes that developing and doing examination which is reliable and valid, because the board examinations are conducted throughout a finite set of a population. If it is a board examination, then it will be conducted throughout the state board, for the state board. And for if it is a CBSE board, it will be conducted throughout the country. So the achievement scores that we are getting, that must be reliable and valid. in order to establish the reliability and validity of examinations. So this state proposes that the examination should be focused towards improving the reliability and validity of the examination. So that was the one of the important focus of this policy. Then the next focus of the policy was that the examinations that we are doing, that must be a continuous to aim at helping students to improve their level of achievement rather than certifying the quality of their performance at a given moment of a time. Because when we are conducting examination in a one shot, okay, one shot examination we are doing. It may be the annual examination or a semester examination, whatever the kind of examination is that. If it is a one sort of examination, one examination only we are giving, then it is a merely certifying that what is the performance of a student at that particular moment of a time, not the actual performance of the student. Why? Because the performance of a student at that particular moment of a time may be dependent upon the and it may be affected by the various factor. Maybe the student was not physically, mentally, emotionally fit at that time, and that's why the performance of the child is poor in that examination. But we cannot say that the student performance is not up to the mark, because it gives the performance of a student at a particular moment of a time, which is not a real one. And how we can make it real? We can make it real when we will have a continuous assessment and evaluation throughout the year, throughout the learning process. They will be continuously assessed and evaluated. Then we can say that the certificate of achievement, which is saying the performance of a child, is an authentic one, which is the real one, isn't it? So our focus must be to have an assessment and evaluation continuous one. So when we talk about the 1968 policy, these two things are emphasized. That one is the reliability and the validity of examination, and the second one, the continuity in the assessment and evaluation process. And it also says one more thing when you will read, I am reading the sentence for you, that to make evaluation a continuous process aimed at helping students to improve their level of achievement. Which means that the continuous assessment and evaluation process will be reflective in nature and to help the student and to identify their difficulty in the learning process and simultaneously to identify and improve the modality of intervention. If the intervention, if the modality of a teaching learning process, if the modality of a pedagogical approach, if it is not well suited to the student, so that while doing a continuous assessment, you will be able to identify it and on time, you will be able to take a necessary step. So when we talk about the 1968 policy, we can conclude that even at that time, I'm not saying that to which extent we were able to apply that, we were able to do that. That may be another point of a discussion. Okay. But in the true sense, at that time, especially when we talk about the examination reform, which is proposed by the policy, was very much visionary in nature and which is still have a significance, which is still significant in the today's situation. Whatever the examination that we have, it must be reliable and valid, because on the basis of their performance in the examination, we are judging the student, we are gauging the performance of a student. So it must be reliable and a valid one. The second thing is that the teaching learning process, we know that the assessment and evaluation is an integral part of a teaching learning process. which is when we will be seeing the other education policy, like that the 86 and the modified one in the 1992, and in the next class when we will see the NEP 2020, which clearly endorse that the assessment and evaluation is an integral part of a teaching learning process. Here clearly it is not mentioned, but they are also endorsing that the teaching learning process, within the teaching learning process, assessment and evaluation should be an integral part of it, so that we can identify the difficulty of a learner on the time, and we can see what kind of a difficulty the child is facing, and we can also identify on the part of a teacher that what is required to do on the part of a teacher to better engage the learner in the learning process. So in that way, in that sense, when we see this, it is a very visionary one, it is a very appropriate, and it has its relevancy for the today's time even. And even the today's education policy, even the assessment and evaluation norms also endorse that the assessment and evaluation must be continuous in nature, and it must be reliable and a valid one. So this is what the NEP 1968 talks about, the examination reform. Similarly, when we go towards the examination reform which is proposed by the National Education Policy 1986. Before that, I will say that in the 68 policy, the vision was given, that what should be the vision. But we know, in order to transact those vision, in order to implement those vision, we need an action point. Action point means that if we are talking that assessment and evaluation should be an integral part, should be a reliable and valid one, and it should be a continuous one. So what are the steps will be taken to ensure those things, that must be given. There must be a programs, there must be a strategy to ensure how we will make it reliable and valid one, how we will make it continuous one, and how we will ensure that the students are getting benefit out of it. That must be enlisted, which was not there in the 68 policy, and that's why we could not able to achieve the vision and a mission and the objective of NEP 1968. That was somehow tackled in the 86 policy, and when the 86 policy was modified in the 1992, it has come up with a program of action, and that's why we know the 1992 basically for the program of action, POA, because that time we have not brought the new education policy. Rather than when we will be bringing the program of action, so we have thought that almost 4-6 years of our time has passed, so based upon the need and a demand of our time, we can modify something in the 86 policy. So that's why the 1992 is remembered for the basically program of action, okay, because that time we have not brought the new education policy. Then when we see the 86 policy, the 86 policy says that here the basic function of assessment and evaluation and a schooling and a teaching learning process should be to motivate the child for attending the school and learn. That we have to do, because the student were not coming to the school. We can easily see from the enrollment ratio, enrollment, gross enrollment ratio, and the dropout rate. what is the enrollment rate, gross enrollment ratio, and a dropout rate. We will find that the dropout rate was high and the enrollment ratio was very low, which means the majority of the students were out of the school. So this policy says that we have to work for motivating the child, encouraging the child, welcoming the child to attend the school and learn. And that's why it also proposes that the child who are the first generation learner, so for them, we should allow to set their own pace and be given a supplementary remedial instruction, because they are the first generation learner. So they may take a little bit more time than the others, those who are a second or third or the fourth, like that, the generation of learner. Because the learning and schooling culture is not in the child who are the first generation learner. Their socioeconomic condition may not be very well. Their environment may be very conducive. So it proposes that those who are the first generation learner, for them we may allow to set their own pace. If they are not able to complete the education of a grade in a one academic year, they may be given a time to repeat that. Okay, and this must be motivated and they must be encouraged to come to the school and learn. So that was the another reason when we talk about the 86 policy. Then they also says that non-detention at a primary stage will be retained, and making evaluation as a disaggregated as far as possible, and the corporal punishment will be demotivated. There will be no system of corporal punishment. Why these steps was taken, that demotivating, removing the corporal punishment, and a non-detention till the primary stage? It was due to that many students are afraid of coming to school because of the corporal punishment which is given at the school. So it demotivates the learner. This policy visualizes that since the enrollment ratio is very low and the dropout rate is very high, so students are not coming to the school. So first we have to bring them in the school. Then we can work later on. First they should come in the school. If they are not coming in the school, then how we can work with them? So that's why the no detention policy and the removing corporal punishment was emphasized. Even some of the students don't prefer to come to the school because they feel that their performance is not at par with the performance of other students. Suppose that they are failing and they feel an incident of a shame, that all peer member of my class passed and they went to a next grade and I could not perform up to their level and I am in the same class. And it has also been seen that failing of a student have a direct link with their dropouts. There is a correlation between the dropout rate and the failing a student in a primary stage. It has been established by the several researches. So that's why it talks that these two things should be taken care of. At a primary level, there will be a no detention and there will be a no place of a corporal punishment. Then this was the two things. Then it also says that since learning process is not only the involvement of a cognitive part, it also involves the other thing, which is a co-curricular aspect, that is the physical education, physical aspect, then the games, sport and music, cultural activity. These all things are the integrated part of a teaching learning process. So that's why this policy says that sports and a physical education are an integral part of a learning process and will be included in the evaluation of a performance. So all those things should be promoted, not only promoted, but it will be evaluated also. And it will be taken to calculate the performance of a child. So this was the overall vision of this 86 policy. The first one is that there should be a strategy to motivate so that the school, the student should come to the school and learn. There will be no place of corporal punishment, and there will be no detention policy till the primary stage, and there will be an equal emphasis, equal place of the physical education. Then in the light of this, because they have prepared a vision, that what should be a vision, but in order to vision make it true, they have come up with some program of action, and within that they say that first, the elimination of excessive element of chance of subjectivity. So, in the process of assessment and evaluation, the steps will be taken to eliminate the excessive chance of subjectivity. Because we know that in the subjectivity, the assessment and evaluation is not very authentic one, and it depends upon the subject. Subject who is assessing and who is assessed. So, the chances of subjectivity should be eliminated. And in order to eliminate the subject of excessive element of and the chance of subjectivity, they propose that there may be weightages of continuous assessment. So that if the child is performing poor in some of the assessment session, so overall the performance of the child will not be affected. And it will also reduce the examination pressure on the part of a child. So that was one of the element, that was the one of the step which was proposed by the 1986 policy together with the its modification in 1992. That was one of the proposal. And the second thing is that so many students, they are poor in memorization. And they can understand the thing, but they cannot memorize and write and reproduce in the examination. So there should be a de-emphasis on the memorization, and it has other objectives also. Because when we talk about the examination which promotes the memorization, it also leads to a rote learning. Because here the student will try to memorize and they will not understand the concept. So there was a de-emphasis on the memorization to make the teaching learning process more child-centric and more fruitful. Because when if it is a memory-based examination, then the child will lead to remember, which will lead to again the rote learning. So the rote learning was de-emphasized, and that's why there was a de-emphasis on the part of a memorization in the assessment and evaluation process. How we will do? By first, by having a continuous examination, continuous assessment. The second thing is that by reframing the question will be not only memory based, rather than it will have an application based question, it will have a problem solving based question. So that type of a question will be in the assessment and evaluation process to de-emphasize the memorization. The next thing which is proposed by this 86 policy is that continuous and comprehensive evaluation that incorporates both scholastic and co-scholastic aspect of education spread over the total span of instruction time. So there will be a continuous that we were talking about, that it should be a continuous and it should be a comprehensive one also, to assess and evaluate the other aspect of a learning. Here when we will talk this 86 policy, they have used a word scholastic and non-scholastic aspect. Non-scholastic, we know that several times I have discussed that this word is not very much appropriate in the present context, and that's why we are using a word co-scholastic. Co-scholastic means everything: game and sport, literary activity, cultural activity, physical education, everything. Their relation with the peer member, punctuality, cleanliness, everything, dedication, everything comes in the co-scholastic aspect, which is very important for the development of a child. So they also proposes that evaluation and assessment will be a continuous and comprehensive one, because the overall goal which we have set is that we have to encourage the child, we have to motivate the child to come to the school and continue the education process. So we have to work to make the teaching, learning and even the assessment child-centric so that they will get motivation. Then the next thing which is proposed by this policy is that effective use of evaluation process by teacher, student and parents. In the teaching learning process and in the evaluation process, the teacher and parent will cooperate, and it will be a child-centered as per the taste and interest of a child. It is not like that if I am not interested in, suppose that game and sport, so the game and sport will be imposed to me. It should be a child-centric, and whatever the interest of a child is, that will be promoted and that will be taken care of. So that the effective use of evaluation process. Then it also says that improvement in the conduct of examination. The examination should not be as a painful activity, rather than it should be a joyful activity. And there was a several steps was initiated, like that when you will see the model suggestion by the NCERT and the steps taken by the state boards of examination, even the CBSE, you will find that there was a several examination reform was proposed to make the improvement in the conduct of examination. One of the thing you can see that there was a provision of extra time to read and understand the question. 15 minutes of time is given, so that the student should not feel pressure of reading a question in a hurry and start writing, because majority of the time the student commit mistake by misunderstanding the question, what the question is demanding. And then the other step was to reduce the subjectivity and to provide a variety of question. Earlier 4-5 question of a long answer type was given to assess and evaluate their performance in the examination. Now we know that there is a variety of methods are used and variety of questions are used. In the CCE, we have opportunity of a project work. We have opportunity of a group work. We have opportunity of a collaborative learning. We have opportunity of being assessed in the school, some part, suppose that it is a 100 mark paper, so 30 mark will be assessed in the school. So in the annual examination, they will have a less pressure of examination, isn't it? And variety of a question, short answer question, long answer question, open-ended question, matching type, like that the variety of a question is given to improve the examination process. Then the next thing which is proposed by this 86 policy is introduction of concomitant change in instructional material and methodology. Because we know that the assessment and evaluation is linked with the teaching learning process. So many times we are emphasizing that it is integral part. So the way we are teaching, it will lead the assessment process. So there should be a variety of instructional material and a pedagogical methodology must be used, not a simple chalk and talk method. There must be a experimentation as and when it is required and necessary. There must be a field trip. There must be a group work. So the variety of teaching learning process is proposed by the 86 policy, that during the teaching learning process, variety of methods must be used. Then the next one says the instruction of semester system from secondary stage in a phased manner. However, it could not be implemented, and it was also one of the steps to reduce the examination pressure and to bring a systemic change in the examination. Because when we have a annual system of examination, we have a much pressure of completing all the content of a year for an examination. Like that, several times I used to talk that when I was in a secondary and a senior secondary level, we were writing examination, and we, in that the question from 9 and 10 was coming at a time, and in the senior secondary also question from 11 and 12 coming together and we were assessed. So it was giving a much pressure on a student. So we have shifted from bringing question from 2 years to give examination at end of every NM. Like that, at the end of 9, there will be one examination, and at the end of 10th, there will be one examination. Similarly, at the end of 11th, there will be examination, and at the end of 12th, there will be examination. So it will be reducing the examination pressure. And it also proposes the use of grades in place of a mark. The grading system is proposed by the in EP 1986, because it has been identified that in the mark system there is an unnecessary throat cut competitions which gives a huge pressure, mental pressure on the part of a student. Student struggle to fetch each and every mark to show their excellency, to show their supremacy, which is unnecessary. Suppose that someone is securing 91 and someone is securing 90. Their performance cannot be categorized in two categories, that someone is securing 90 and someone is securing 91. Their performance is equal. Even you can say that the equal. So, in order to remove all those things, grade system was introduced. And it was proposed that the grade system should be there. And the whole will be graded in some category. I think previously we were talking that CBSE now having a 9-point grade scale, wherein 90 to 100, that will be having a A1, and then 80 to 90 A2, like that the 9-point grade is there. Suppose that if in the 90 to 100 is a 1 grade, so those who are securing 91, 92, 93, there will be no category in the 91 and the 92. All will be in one category, that is the A1. Isn't it? So it was a effort to reduce that unnecessary burden on the part of a student. Let it be in the 9-point or a 10-point. I maybe that I forget it is not in my mind. It may be possible, but ultimately it is reducing the unnecessary pressure and a burden on the part of a student. So that was all about the examination reform which was proposed by the 1968 policy and 86 policy together with the program of action in 1992. In the next class, we will see what is the proposal of National Education Policy 2020. Any question from anybody?
Sir, even if we conduct continuous and comprehensive exam, in the paper pencil test, children use memory method. They just memorize and write. Then how to assess that one?
Okay.
That they are actually capable of understanding.
I think that your question is that even we are doing a continuous and comprehensive evaluation, students are memorizing and they are writing. So actually it is not working to de-emphasize the rote learning. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
See, I think when I was talking about the drawback of CCE, you remember that discussion. What was the limitation of a CCE and why the CCE failed and even why the no detention policy failed. When we have thought of implementing CCE, we have visualized that in the CCE, there will be a no memory test. It will be a assessment by involving them in a group work. The assessment will be involving them by observation, by portfolio assessment, by involving them in the experimentation. So their skills and all those things will be assessed and we will be able to understand. But it was not implemented in its true sense and spirit. When you will find that why we are de-emphasizing CCE and why we are scrapping out the no detention policy, I have clearly outlined in the previous class that they have potential. You cannot question on the potentiality of this modality. The problem was it was not implemented in its true sense and spirit. And why it was not implemented in its true sense and spirit? Because of the huge gap in the student and a teacher ratio. You know that in the several school, even now, 2-3 teachers are managing the whole elementary school. A school from 1 to class 8, it is managed by 2-3 teacher. Some time back, there was so many school with a single teacher. There is a lack of infrastructure. There is a lack of a training. And so many, there is a issue. And that's why it was not implemented in the its true sense and spirit, and that is the cause of a failure of a no detention policy and CCE. And the things you are observing, and even I am observing, I'm not different from you, because I am also in the same society where you are. We are seeing the schools which lacks of infrastructure. And there is a pressure by a government to do the CCE. So what they will do? There is a reason why it became to promote a rote learning. But when it will be done in its true sense and spirit, its potentiality is much more than that. It have a potential. Okay. Smarky, I think you are getting what I am trying to say.